Hi, this is Jose Luis, and in the previous video on this series on Introduction to Parametric Modeling, I explained NURBS geometry, what it was conceptually, but I also explained how to use Rhino, a direct modeling environment, to generate these types of geometry in the 3D modeling environment. Now, what I would like to teach you in this video is how to also generate NURBS geometry, but using the visual programming language Grasshopper that lives inside of Rhino. And in a parametric way, in a way that all the parameters that drive that geometry can be controlled manually with our algorithm. So how are we going to do that? Well, as you can see from the previous, and you should know that from this, the previous videos that in the series, I have created a parametric point that starts at coordinate X, Y, and Z. And you can see that I can control the three coordinates of each one of them and move it in three-dimensional space. So what I'm going to do is, in this exercise, I'm going to create four points, and then I'm going to join these four parametric points with straight line segments. I'm also going to join them with a polyline, and then I'm going to join them with NURBS curves. One of them is going to be using control points as the input parameters, and the other one is going to be using interpolation points as the input parameters. Very similar to how I did in the previous video. So the way I'm going to do this is I'm just going to select all of this and I'm going to copy paste it four times. So I'm going to create a second point, I'm going to create a third point, and I'm going to create a fourth point. And because you know that I like things to be neat and clean, I'm going to right away select all of these, press Ctrl G, and then group them so that I can now move them around. And this, if I right click here and I type input parameters, these are going to be all the coordinates of my four points. You can see that my four points, all of them are overlapping on 0, 0, 0. So right now I'm just going to move them a little bit so that I can have like a bit more of a 3D perception of where they are, if you will, or something like that. And then here, this one is going to be all the way here and it's going to be in negative. So you can see now that my four points are somewhere here in 3D space, you can see, and they form this kind of situation. All right. Okay, so let's start simple. The first thing we're going to do is we're going to join each one of these points, each one of these pairs of points, with simple line segments. The way we can do that is if we go to the Curves tab, and if we go to Primitives, you can see that one of the first ones that I have is a simple line between two points. Okay, so I can click that one and drop it on the canvas. And then what I can do is I can say, well, the first input point is going to be point A, and the end point is going to be point B. And you can see that immediately I get a pre-visualization here. And as we have seen in previous videos, because everything is parametric, if I change the coordinates of the input points, I will change where the starting point and the end point of this particular line lies. So now I can double click and drop another line component between two points, and then send the second line is going to start with the second point and it's going to end at the third point. And I'm going to double click again, type line, find this one, and the third line is going to start from the third point and it's going to end at the fourth point. All right. Wonderful. And I'm going to align these guys, distribute them evenly and group them. And this is going to be three line segments that join my three points. You can see, and everything is parametrically bound. Everything is driven by these four points that can be controlled parametrically and that define these three line segments. Okay, this is great. Now, these three lines are three individual line segments. But sometimes what we want, perhaps, is to have one single polyline that joins the four points that I am parametrically modeling. So if I go to Curves and to Primitive again, you can see that somewhere, not in Primitives, but this case in Splines, is we can find the polyline component. Okay, polyline, as you can see from the description, creates a polyline connecting a number of points. So what I'm going to do is, first of all, I'm going to select all these lines and I'm going to right click, I'm going to middle click and disable the pre-visualization. Or actually, you can do Control Q to disable the preview visualization so that they don't show up here and I can see what's going on. You see that they turn dark gray. We've seen this in previous videos. So now what I'm going to do is I'm going to use these 4 points to feed into the input of the component. The component has an input that is called vertices, and you can see that the description says that it's a list of vertices, which means that I have to plug in all the vertices in this same input. And then this has another input that says whether if I want to make the polyline closed or not. And this symbol, the symbol with a circle and a half moon inside of it, means in Grasshopper terms, it means that that parameter is a Boolean. Boolean means something that can either be true or false. So I will show you how that works. Okay, so in the vertices, we need to plug in the points for the polyline as a list. So if I start plugging in the first one, and then I plug in the second one, you're going to see that the second one snaps the first one out. And if I do the third one, you're going to see that it snaps the second one out. So this is not good, okay? Because what I need to do is I need to plug them all together in here. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to plug in the first one, and then to make sure that the second one also adds in without snapping anything out, I'm going to make sure that as I join it, I press the shift button. You see how my icon turns into a green arrow and a plus sign? That means that I'm going to be adding an input here. So I have added a second input, and then here I'm going to add a third input, and here I'm pressing shift to add a fourth point to the list. You can see that I have now connected the 4 points to the same input, which is great, and which gives me a polyline object, a polyline curve here coming out of this. And if I click, you can see that this all turns green. This component now has a polyline. I may want to choose to close the polyline or not. Closing it means that there's no open gap here, that it will always wrap up into the first point of the polyline. And I have to feed it a value that is true or false. So how do I do that? If you go to parameters and you go to inputs, you can see that just as we have sliders for numbers, for inputs, we can have a Boolean toggle. A Boolean toggle is basically something that I can double click to make true or false, true or false. And if I right click here, I can say, is it going to be closed? And then if I plug this in here, I can see that it's not closed, and now it's closed. And you can see how this new segment shows up. Not closed, close. Not closed, close. I'm double clicking on the Boolean toggle. Boolean toggles are like sliders, but only for true and false values. So, okay, so now I have a polyline, and probably I may want to bring my parameter here. So I'm going to select everything and I'm going to right click here. I'm going to make sure that I'm going to make sure that this gets added to the group. Okay. It's typically very, very good practice to keep everything that is a parameter, that is something that you want to work with, at the left end of your definition. Okay. And everything that shouldn't be messed up just on the right hand side. Okay. So I have my polyline. And now what I want to do is I want to use these 4 points as the control points of a nerves curve. The way I can do that is by going to curves, going to spline, and then seeing that here I can create a nerves curve. And you can see that the description says constructs a nerves curve from control polygons. So I'm going to click that, I'm going to drop it in here, and I'm going to take a look at the inputs and the outputs. This is a very good thing to do anytime you are new to Grasshopper. You want to take a look at the components and see what they're asking you for and what they're giving you. So for example, V tells me that I need the vertices, the control points, as a list. So that means that I'm going to have to plug in here all the points. So I'm going to just do the first one, and then the second one with the shift press, the third one with the shift press. Oh, I plugged it in the wrong way. So I'm going to do Control C to undo. The third one on here, and then the fourth one with the shift. You can see that if I click here, this curve turns green, which means that this is the pre visualization of a NURBS curve that uses those four points as their control points. And of course, again, if I change where those points are, like everything updates correspondingly. Everything is parametrically bound. Let's take another look at more inputs. If I look at D, it says that it's the degree of the curve. And the degree has to be, according to the icon, has to be an integer value, a number that has no decimal part. Curves, NURBS curves, cannot have a degree that has decimal part. It has to be an integer. So how do I do that? Well, I can create a slider here, number slider. And if I edit the slider, I can make sure that this is a natural number with minimum being number one and maximum being number three. Because remember, since I have only four points for this particular arrangement, I cannot have a degree larger than three. So I'm going to put this in here. And now if I turn this off, you can see that I have my NURBS curves is now degree one, degree two. So that is touching the control polygon here, and then degree three, which is smoother. Degree two, degree one, degree two, degree three. So this is exactly what I was explaining before. If we had more control points, we could try out degree four, degree five, etc., etc. And then what about P? P is periodic. Periodic is a fancy term in geometry to just say whether if the curve is going to be closed or not. So what we can do is, and you can see that it's a Boolean. So what we can do is we can plug this same input here and say, do we want to close? Yes. So this is a closed NURBS curve in these four control points. And look, if I do degree two, it actually becomes tangent to the control polygon. And if I do degree one, it just becomes a polyline that is closed. And if I open it up, then it goes back. Okay. And then for outputs, we have the resulting NURBS curves. And you see the icon is a nice NURBS curve. If you say L is the curve length, which is apparently 11 units in Rhino space, and D is going to be the domain. Turns out that this curve happens to have a domain from 0 to 1. This is actually really rare for curves, but yes. So so we can plug in a few more panels here, and this is the length, and this is the domain. And I'm going to align and redistribute, and this is a NURBS curve. Okay. So this is very interesting. The component is not only giving us the curve, but a lot of information about that curve, which could be useful down the road for other operations. And last but not least, let's take a look at using these four points to construct an interpolated NURBS curve. The way we do that is I can go to splines and I can go to interpolate, which says create an interpolated curve through a set of points. I'm going to drop this here and you can see that I have a lot of stuff here now. The input is the interpolation points. So I'm going to plug in my vertices. So one, and then the second with a shift, the third pressing the shift, the fourth pressing, the fourth pressing the shift. And you can see that now the curve has appeared and it has, it's going through all the points. You can see that if I zoom in here on the other inputs, I also have a degree input. So let's plug in here and let's see what an interpolated degree of curve of degree two looks like. Okay, which looks very similar to me, because I guess it has to be degree two, because it cannot be less than degree two. Interpolation does not allow even degrees. Okay, so what this component does not allow even degrees for some reason. And then P is whether if the curve is periodic or not. So we're going to plug this in here and then we're going to turn it on and you can see how the curve does this. I'm going to turn the other one off. You can see how the interpolated curve does this weird egg shape kind of kinky thing here, which is kind of interesting, actually. Oops, I think I got lost. All right. Oh, yeah, because it does this weird twist because of how the points are in 3D space. All righty. And then Q is called the knot spacing, which is a way of, this is very difficult to explain, it's a way of distributing how the tangencies of, not the tangencies, how the domain is distributed across the nerve space, more or less, but not really. Anyway, if you want to control this, you can add here a number so that you change the type of knot style to uniform, to chord, or to square chord. All right, and the outputs are going to be, I think, pretty much the same. One is going to be the curve, the other one is going to be the length of the curve, and the other one is going to be the domain. And you can see that the domain now is from 0 to 24 point something something. All right. Okie dokie. So these are the four ways we have of creating curves. For example, we can, between four points, we can create straight line segments, we can create polylines, we can create nerves curves from control points, and we can create nerves curves through interpolation over those points. All right. Wonderful. So this is great. And I think this was a good introduction to simple generation of curves in Grasshopper. Now, what I would like to take a look at now on the next video is how to, for example, having these four points in Grasshopper might be a little tedious, and sometimes working with coordinates, depending on what we're doing, can also be a little tedious. So I would like to show you in the next video how to work with, instead of using parametrically generated geometry as inputs to generate form, how to create actual geometry that is coming in from Rhino to generate form. So stay tuned for that on the next video, how to import Rhino geometry into Grasshopper. And as usual, if you like what you saw, consider subscribing to the channel, liking this video, etc., etc. Thanks a lot. See you on the next video.